Have you ever seen a rock that isn't a rock? I mean, like, have you ever seen a rock that is something resembling a stone but wasn't formed by natural processes? I have. It's something very interesting produced by humans through our factory processes, and it is this. It is called fordite. Why is the word fordite used, though? Well, it's because it is actually an aggregate of enamel paint coating used on old Ford cars from the 40s all the way up through the 70s and 80s. And as they were painting these cars, excess of it would run off onto the factory floor plant and get on pieces of equipment and stuff. And it would take about 1,000 layers of paint to make about an inch of this material that you're seeing now. But then some workers found out that you can polish and shape this stuff like actual stone. And so fordite became something of a material that you could sell and make into jewelry. Fordite is on the market right now, and you can buy some, but there's a limited amount because they changed the system that painted the cars, much more efficient, and so now there isn't this buildup of excess paint on factory floors, and so fordite is a limited quantity, and it's quite beautiful. A human-made gem born out of inefficiency. What is it, baseball? Yeah, that's right. Baseball sucks. Hello, and welcome to another edition of Footnotes, the companion show to Because Science, where I take all of your comments, questions, and corrections, and I peel them back like aggregate layers of enamel paint, and then I break some off and I polish it up into a stone of science, and then I tell you what's coming up on this channel next. Hint, it involves neutron stars and doing dangerous stuff with it. Who would have thought? But getting right into it, in the last episode of Because Science, we were trying to figure out what a darksaber is, a singular weapon crafted by the first Mandalorian Jedi. If it's supposed to function like a lightsaber, what makes a darksaber the way it is? How does it have the properties that it has? In the full episode, which you can watch if you haven't yet, I said that if the darksaber was like a black hole blade, then it would explain the absence of light in the blade. It might explain the glow, the hot glow around the edge of the blade as some sort of accretion disk like forms around black holes, and that accretion disk could be so hot it might in fact cut stuff. Of course, my explanation created just as many problems as it attempted to solve, but hey, sometimes you just gotta get ripped apart by intensely strong magnetic fields. Wish! What did you have to say? Our first comment comes from Neospacian Sushi Roll, who says, I have a hypothesis about how the darksabers work. They look cool, so it works. That's how things in Star Wars works. It's cool. It is inarguable that Star Wars as a franchise created some of the coolest sci-fi designs of all time. No doubt that's why they have stuck around for the last couple of decades and they've influenced so much science fiction going forward. If it's cool, it's cool. I mean, you know, lightsabers are awesome, but as for an explanation, it'd be a lot cooler if they had one. Yes, it would. My heroes, myself in 10 years, you know what I'm talking about? Ooh. Yelster has a comment who says, hey Kyle, great show. Eh. Is there any science currently which could explain such sci-fi concepts as force fields or force shields? Well, yes, but you would need some sort of field, like a gravitational field, a magnetic field, an electrical field, that could impose a force on an object moving through that field. So say we're making a spaceship and we want to deflect incoming cosmic radiation. How do we protect ourselves? Well, one of the ideas is to create a kind of magnetic force field or force shield, if you will, and this involves projecting a magnetic field outside of the spacecraft, kind of like how the Earth's magnetosphere is projected outside of the sphere of the Earth itself by the dynamo spinning at the core. So if we projected a magnetic field outside of our spaceship, when those particles, those cosmic particles encountered the magnetic field, they would experience some force from the magnetic field and would be diverted around our spaceship. This would be a real-ish force field. For anything to divert like bullets or lightsabers, you would need something a lot stronger, something that would have a lot of knock-on effects that you'd notice, like, you know, ripping everything apart near you. Alejandro Fernandez Castro says, Kyle, who do you talk to at the end of the videos? I mean them? I wouldn't worry about them. Don't you dare get on camera. Douglas Wallace, Ray 33, Brain Gizim, and others say, well, for a darksaber, what about using antimatter? How would that work? Antimatter is cool, and as you know, in Star Wars, all right, cool rules. But antimatter would be a pretty bad thing to make a blade that you hold near your face out of, if for no other reason, then sure, you could contain antimatter in, say, a magnetic field, like a magnetic trap so that it doesn't interact with anything and it doesn't, you know, explode. But once you bring that lightsaber into contact with anything, if the blade is made out of antimatter, that antimatter will react with the matter that it touches and annihilate, releasing energy according to E=mc². And if you had a lightsaber blade's worth of antimatter and you contacted that blade with a blade's worth of normal matter, it would create an explosion large enough to level the city. Unless your whole planet was a city, then it would just be part of it. It's a Coruscant joke. But the nerdiest comment at the time I'm filming this video, I gotta give to Lars Van Den Bigelar, who says, so what Kyle is saying at the beginning of the video is that lightsabers' colors are dependent on their temperatures, right? If so, then I have two questions, and I wanna get to your first one. Could you consider blue lightsabers to be more dangerous than red ones as they seemingly have a higher temperature? So yes, according to that Veen's displacement law that we looked at during the episode, blue to bluish white hot is the hottest region of visible light. If something is blue or white hot, it is the hottest. And if it's reddish or orangish, then it is red hot, but that is necessarily at a lower temperature. It has to be if it's acting like black body radiation. So yes, even though the temperature difference isn't all that much, relatively speaking, you still have thousands of Kelvin versus thousands of Kelvin, but a Jedi's blue lightsaber, usually wielded by Jedi, right, would be technically physically hotter in our estimation than a Sith's red lightsaber, and you'd want to fear the blue one more.
Strong the light side of the Force is, and hotter our lightsabers do.
They cut that line. I did submit it to Lucas, but he cut it. Don't you dare get on camera! But Lars, for that very interesting point, you are indeed a super nerd. But of course, I'm not always right. Sometimes I'm Kylo Ren. So what did I get wrong last week? It's a Star Wars pun. The bad one. Oh, and if you are watching outside of the time when I publish this video and you want to correct me on something, I'm sure that you do, make sure you like and subscribe to this channel and hit that notification bell so you can get all the video notifications so you can get in there and say, oh, but Kyle, Our first correction comes from Super Nerd Infinite Asim, who says, okay, I did some research and I found out what's much more viable than a black hole sword. It's just a regular lightsaber that contains an invisible plasma. In the Korean tokamak K-Star, which you can read about, the plasma here is a blistering 150 million degrees C, and it isn't visible. It is because it simply doesn't emit light in the visible spectrum. A darksaber could be that. Well, Infinite, I do like your comment, but two problems with it. One, just like you said, if it's not emitting any visible light, it wouldn't necessarily look black, would it? That's something that is taking in all the radiation, like a perfect black body or like a black hole like we suggested. And if you look up footage of tokamak reactors switching on and in operation, I'm not totally sure what you're talking about because I can see a lot of hot, hot plasma in there. And I wouldn't want to touch it. Don't touch it. Don't touch it. Hey, KevKiller777 has a correction who says, humans breathe oxygen, citation needed. But in the episode, you were drawing lots of helium atoms. Does that mean you breathe helium? Does that mean you're not from Earth? Does that mean you're an alien supervillain who wants to replace all oxygen on Earth with helium?
No, that's completely ridiculous. I don't breathe only helium. As a half-set? What a weird correction.
Another big correction comes from Doom for Zombies, who says the darksaber shouldn't cut through a Mandalorian helmet. And in the opening of the episode, I have Boba Fett's helmet being cut by a lightsaber, but of course, as you know, a Mandalorian armor is the only armor in the Star Wars universe that can repel a lightsaber attack, so it wouldn't necessarily cut through Boba Fett's helmet like that, like I showed just to illustrate the point of lightsabers cutting stuff. Come on. But the nerdiest correction at the time I'm filming this episode, I'm giving to Adrian, who says, hey Kyle, love the show. One quick observation, if the light emitted by a lightsaber was simply due to the heat alone of its plasma as dictated by Veen's law, then you could not have all the colors that we see in the movies. You could only add up the colors from the large wavelength end of the spectrum to the smaller wavelength end, i.e. red, orange, yellow, then white, and eventually blue for the hottest plasmas. In the same way, there are no green stars, there could be no green lightsaber. In case you've never thought about this, no, there are in fact no green stars in the universe. Some stars may look green to our eyes after the light passes through the atmosphere, but this is an optical illusion. There are no green stars, period, and that's because if stars are emitting light like near-perfect black-body radiators as they are, then we can actually characterize how that light will look in the visible portion in the spectrum, and it just so happens that even though some stars can emit most of their wavelengths in green light specifically, because they're also emitting red light and blue light, because of how all those colors combine, no stars will ever look green, at least according to the physics here in this universe. As long as Star Wars is still in the same universe, if it's just using plasma alone and temperature like you're saying, Adrian, then there can be no green lightsabers. It would have to be more like a gas discharge, mercury vapor kind of thing going on, but then it probably wouldn't be hot enough to cut through stuff, and this is a great correction, so you are a super nerd. Had to get that out. And now, moving right along to this week's episode of Because Science. You can get this at the Nerdist store. The next episode of Because Science is the neutron star slingshot. That's right, in the next episode of Because Science, we are delving into decades-old research into a kind of gravitational machine featuring neutron stars, which may end up being the ultimate in interstellar transportation. You thought I was gonna say something, didn't you? Didn't you? But before we get to the neutron star slingshot, please go watch the latest episode of Because Science if you haven't yet, all about whatever it was, and leave me your best comments, corrections, and questions at youtube.com/becauseScience, facebook.com/becauseScience, and at Because Science on wherever you type that in and you get stuff, and it is me. And don't forget, I don't know who out there needs to hear this, so I'm not gonna say it.